Fatima in northern Taiwan recently made one of their regular visits to Pingxi to care for solitary seniors there. We'll hear a bit about the history of the Da'ai TV station as station staff and the Tsuji Foundation continue to move forward.
Welcome to Da'ai Headlines. I'm Duncan DeAith, and thank you for joining us. TIMA members and volunteers in northern Taiwan recently headed to Pingxi to provide free medical services to solitary seniors in the community. Since most of the young people have left to look for jobs, many seniors have been left there alone, and transportation in the area is inconvenient and medical resources are insufficient, which is where TIMA comes in.
This 90-year-old senior feels pain in one of her eyes. On her way to Tsuji's free medical outreach, she encounters TIMA members, so the doctors check her eyes right next to the railway. To safeguard the health of seniors living in Pingxi District, the TIMA Northern Taiwan Chapter provides free medical services for them once every 2 months. Through these care visits, young volunteers have learned a lot about the daughter-patient's relationship.
This is quite different from the way when we interact with the patients at the hospital. One of the seniors doesn't have the company of her family, so she needs us to care for her regularly and give her love and care. This way, she can feel the company of other people.
The deputy superintendent, Dr. Xu, said if we could talk a lot more with the seniors, then we should try our best to do it. He said by doing this diligently, the patients will feel at ease. I think I've learned a lot from this experience.
Seniors living in the mountainous area are not only troubled by chronic diseases, but they also lack the care of their family. Therefore, the visits of the medical team alongside volunteers can bring them much warmth and love.
For some grandpas and grandmas, we should not merely provide them with medical assistance, but we should also talk to them and give them care. I think this is also very important.
At this free medical outreach, Dr. Li Jiafu from the Taipei Tsuji Hospital gives a lecture on dementia, which helps the senior prevent this illness as well as live a better life in their later years.
This lecture allows local residents and their family to understand what dementia is. It will make things more convenient when taking care of this kind of patients in the future.
With the company and care of Tsuji volunteers and TIMA members once every 2 months, the seniors in Pingxi have gradually developed a good friendship with them.
On the visit to Pingxi, TIMA's Northern Taiwan Chapter and the Taipei Tsuji Hospital screened seniors for dementia in response to the government's Long-Term Care Act 2.0. Once diagnosed with suspected symptoms of dementia, seniors will have the chance to take part in weekly rehabilitation courses to delay the onset of this disease.
83-year-old Mrs. Hu and her daughter took the train on Sunday to visit the Pingxi Public Health Center, where they participated in a special TIMA-sponsored activity. A few days earlier, medical volunteers visited Mrs. Hu at home, where they did an initial screening and suspected she exhibited early signs of dementia. Therefore, special arrangements were made for this more in-depth diagnosis. In the Pingxi area, there are about 100 people like Mrs. Hu who live alone and are joined on the weekends by their children. TIMA worked with Taipei Tsuji Hospital to hold this screening activity at the Pingxi Public Health Center.
In these elderly communities, we want to interact with people when they are still healthy. Intervening at this time can allow us to provide long-term follow-up care.
Through this screening, early detection of cognitive impairment can lead to non-drug-related treatment to activate these seniors' brain and memory function.
There is a class for seniors and another for their families. This is available to them every week to join, and this group activity not only includes physical movement, but also exercises for the brain.
The screening has identified 8 elderly people who need follow-up care in these weekly rehabilitation classes. Tsuji and the government is hoping that more of these programs can identify those with dementia, which is a growing problem in Taiwan's aging society.
In China, students from the Tianjing School in Jiangsu's Kunshan mostly come from underprivileged families, as most of their parents came from other provinces looking for employment. To help these families, Ziji has been providing subsidies for the children's tuition. Recently, Ziji volunteers went door to door to check on living conditions of the students.
He was abandoned by his mother, so his grandfather and I raised him up.
Listening to his grandmother talk about his background with volunteers, Li Haoqi sits aside and keeps silent. He has an excellent academic record. The only thing he worries about is his grandmother's health. Ziji volunteers in Kunshan go door to door to care for some impoverished students from the Tianjin School. At the beginning of each semester, the mother of the Liu family usually worries about her two sons' tuition.
In our daily life, I think it is fine, but every time when we need to pay for the tuition, I feel especially anxious because the total cost of the tuition for my two children is more than $1,465.
Sympathizing with their mother's hard work, these two children express their sincere gratitude to their mother in front of volunteers. Li Xiaojie, who comes from Gansu, has suffered from asthma since he was young. His single mother is almost unable to afford his medical expenses and tuition. Ziji volunteers make their way to Peng Yikai's home. Despite their poor financial condition, he hasn't lost confidence in his life, even though he is too shy to express gratitude.
来，每个人都抱抱，师姑也抱抱我们这个宝贝啊，然后祝福你啊，加油哈！Ziji
volunteers treat scholarship recipients as their own children, as they care for them with love to help them grow up healthy and happy.
In Muar, Malaysia, Lau Lihui was diagnosed with acute myeloid leukemia in May last year. She had to travel frequently from Muar to Malacca for chemotherapy. The Ziji family in Muar and Malacca have been offering love and support while accompanying her during her treatment. Recently, she successfully underwent a bone marrow transplant. Here's more.
At the blessing ceremony, everyone is giving Lau Lihui support because she was diagnosed with acute myeloid leukemia in May last year and has been battling with her illness ever since.
Although it needs a lot of effort, I should be brave because many people around me give me their best wishes.
Living in Muar, Mrs. Lau has to frequently travel from Muar to Malacca to receive chemotherapy at a local hospital. The Ziji family in these two places take turns to take care of her.
Because she vomited, she couldn't sleep and she worried a lot. We hope she can concentrate on her treatment and doesn't need to worry about her diet because her sister, me, and its Ziji sister will coordinate with one another.
After chemotherapy, I had a poor appetite, so she cooked porridge for me. This really moved me.
You should take good care of yourself and your sister too. You two should give each other the best wishes.
Fortunately, Mrs. Lau's sister is matching marrow donor, and she successfully underwent bone marrow transplantation this year.
Because of everyone's blessing and care, I can recover from my illness soon.
We have been accompanying her all the way. Of course, we know this is a difficult time for her, and it is not easy. This is a big challenge for her, especially she may feel physically and mentally stressful.
I never thought the world would be full of love.
With everyone's blessing and care, Mrs. Lau feels grateful, as she now wants to pay love forward by continuing to walk the Bodhisattva path and learn more from Dharma teachings.
Next, we'll visit a meeting at a Jingsa Books and Cafe in Kuala Lumpur, Malaysia. A nutritionist came to give a lecture on keeping healthy and preventing cancer. Let's hear what she had to say.
In medicine, they call it cancer, but for nutritionists, we call it a growth of an aerobic cell. That means that it hates oxygen.
This lecture at a Jingsi Books and Cafe in Kuala Lumpur is about how to prevent and overcome cancer.
If you get sick and then go to find a method for treatment, we call that cultivating sickness. But when you are not sick and mind your health and diet, eating nutritious foods, that is called keeping healthy.
We should avoid giving cancer an opportunity to develop. There's three ways to avoid that. One is not to let your body become acidic. Another is to keep your body oxygenated. You can do that with regular exercise. And the last is simply to avoid eating too much sugar.
The theory for keeping healthy and treating sickness is actually very simple.
You should try to maintain a happy outlook. That is really important. I think it is especially important for your family and those around you. Just because a person is sick or has cancer, people around them should not be nervous or somber. This will affect the patients and make treatments even more difficult.
The lecture also includes an on-site teaching demonstration on how to make healthy veggie drinks. The process is easy enough to do at home and is a nutritious snack that will contribute to keeping everyone healthy.
Since Da'ai TV started broadcasting in 1998, it has encountered numerous difficulties, such as renting spaces for offices and also being flooded by Typhoon Nari in 2001. But the TV station has continued to broadcast love and wholesome news. Recently, senior volunteers and staff discussed the history of the station. Wang Tuanzheng, vice president of the Ziji Foundation, encouraged all staff to expand the influence of Da'ai TV.
Each photograph represents a moment in history of Da'ai TV. For 19 years, the TV station had to rent office space and encounter turmoil caused by floods. Finally, Da'ai TV has its own home.
For 2 years, I constantly bought soy juice, buns, and flatbread, and took a taxi to bring them to construction workers when they were working overtime at night to pour cement.
When we saw bricks and tiles become this tall building, this is our biggest blessing at Guandu Grounds. The master once told us that this district was a cultural area, so we had to absorb it into our hearts.
The work by many people accomplished this building, and Ziji volunteers have created a special culture and touched the hearts of many construction workers.
Besides our volunteers, our staff should also show their care and accompany the construction workers who will be building an ideal building for us.
Ziji's spirit will continue passed down through right knowledge and views. This meeting is full of wonderful memories and love.
The chairman of the UN Department of Public Information Office, Bruce Knotts, became Master Zheng Yan's disciple last year and has been promoting vegetarianism through the United Nations. This year, he made another visit to the Jingsi Abode in Hualien, Taiwan. He also took the opportunity to work as a hospital volunteer for the first time and spread Dharma teachings to inmates at a jail. Let's take a look.
Walking through several iron gates, the chairman of the United Nations Department of Public Information Office, Bruce Knotts, takes the opportunity to spread Dharma teachings with volunteers at a jail after he became master's disciple that year.
Do something new. You can set new goals and set new things that you want to do with your life. Today is the first day of the rest of your life.
Always be grateful. You must be brave and strong. We will recover soon.
Bruce also makes his way to Hualien Ziji Hospital to experience being a hospital volunteer for the first time. The compassion and medical culture of Ziji have deeply impressed this guest from the United Nations.
Even how the food tastes and really caring. There's a level of caring about people rather than just masses of people feeding a lot of people or something like that, but caring for each individual and caring for them as a person, that's very impressive to me.
Ciji has continued to care for those who are suffering in jails and hospitals. Through these caring visits alongside Ciji volunteers, Bruce has learned a lot from this experience and will help spread this power of love as well as Ciji's spirits all over the world when he gets back to his work.
Taiwan began installing solar panels above fish farms after Typhoon Morakot in 2009. Due to salinization and heavy sediment left by the typhoon, a program was inaugurated in 2010 to help farmers whose fish farms were damaged. The project included conserving groundwater and selling electricity from solar panels to Thai Power. Here's more on the initiatives Taiwan is taking towards a sustainable energy policy.
Following Typhoon Morakot in 2009, Pingdong County's Linbian experienced heavy rain, along with seawater flooding the area as the streets became covered in mud.
It was the largest flooding I have ever experienced. I think that all of Linbian was covered in mud, which may cause us to become an abandoned town.
Few thought the Pingdong County government would propose a solar panel initiative for these affected farmers to help them recover.
This crisis actually turned into an opportunity, as there was little way to use this land, as we needed to promote solar energy and water conservation. We have simply been pumping groundwater for too many years, so the chance to generate electricity and reduce dependence on groundwater would let the ground recover.
After a period of evaluation, Thai Power selected 45 hectares on either side of the Linbian Creek, which had been used for fish ponds and wax apple gardens, to install solar panels. This 10-hectare area is the Guangtai Wetlands, which has become a microgrid demonstration area for solar power. The total solar and wind power device capacity is 88 kilowatt, with a smart system distributing electricity where it is needed. But on rainy, windless days where no electricity is generated, a 60 kilowatt biofuel generator is on hand, which can produce 72 hours of continuous power.
Our original centralized power network became a decentralized power grid, as our roof has solar panels and wind power, and we also have fuel cells to be self-sufficient.
Guangtai Wetlands not only provide solar power and flooding control measures, but also water purification functions for aquaculture fisheries.
The wastewater from these fish breeding ponds is sent to the wetlands, with these plants automatically adjusting and cleaning the water, reducing the pollution by the time it is sent back to the sea.
In addition to solar panels above fish ponds and floating solar power generation, can all be found in Pingdong County.
The total area of water is nearly 9,000 square meters, and 3,300 have been covered with solar panels, generating 659,000 kilowatts of electricity annually, which can supply the electrical needs for 180 households.
Furthermore, the use of environmentally friendly materials and the ability to overcome potential damage from typhoons and floods and limited land makes floating solar photovoltaic systems a major new direction in the development of Taiwan solar energy.
We checked all of Taiwan last year, and according to an announcement from the Bureau of Energy, water solar power systems can reach 1.8 gigawatts, which is a very large amount.
Moving the location of solar panels from land to water also leads to issues regarding water resource management and related government regulations, which are just in the initial stage of development. Potentially more lakes or reservoirs could see solar panels deployed, though the impact on the environment has yet to be properly assessed.
In our next piece, we'll visit Kaohsiung to meet a young disabled lady, Xue Jun, who has been receiving assistance from another young lady, Afan. Afong was hired for the job through a program of the Social Affairs Bureau designed to provide assistance to people suffering from mental and physical disabilities.
Meet Afong. She is busy picking out colors of fabric in this art shop, but these purchases are not for her. She is actually shopping for her employer, who sent her out to pick up the material. This is Shui Jun, who suffers from muscular dystrophy. She must rely on a wheelchair to travel and requires regular assistance. That's where Afong comes in. She is Shui Jun's personal assistant and a graduate student who also works part-time in a bridal shop.
This job really means a lot to me. I can help someone who needs it, and other than companionship.
While offering care and assistance to Shui Jun, Afong becomes her hands and legs, and thanks to their cooperation, Afong is helping Shui Jun do all the things she can't do on her own.
At first, I was quite shy, but after having help from an assistant, I was finally able to complete all the things I wanted to complete. For example, I was able to start sewing dolls. When my assistant found out I wanted to make the dolls, she encouraged me to take the test to get an artist license to sell them on the street. So I did, and I passed.
Working as an assistant caregiver, 1 hour is only about $4. The amount of subsidies varies in accordance to the condition of the mental or physical disability. For households with no income or low income, 100% will receive some form of government assistance.
In the past, disabled people like Shui Jun could only dream about plans and projects, but thanks to the assistant program that brought her and Afong together, she now has the help she needs to make her dreams come true, despite her disabilities.
In Malaysia, volunteers from Jingsi Books and Cafe in Selangor recently gave a talk on environmental protection at a local company. They also shared some snacks made from Jingsi food products and encouraged everyone to adopt a vegetarian diet.
City volunteers are invited to this company to join the Lovely Earth Week event. They turn instant rice into one-bite sushis and organic grains into small desserts.
I noticed they were quite excited when they approached to see our products. After they ate them, they said they tasted good and it made us feel happy.
We should protect the environment and adopt a vegetarian diet. We shouldn't eat a lot of meat. If we are vegetarians, we can still be very healthy.
Office workers can protect the environment by doing it in their office.
Recycling is not about today, it's about every day. So we do a lot of recycling in the office, you know. So whenever we go shopping also we don't buy bags. Recycling is on everyday basis.
When we talk about recycling, the first thing comes to my mind is Ciji, because Ciji has given me a deep impression that they not only protect the environment, but also help people.
This event helps to raise more awareness on environmental protection.
At Suji Kindergarten in Butterworth, Malaysia, the young students are learning about respecting and protecting life with their Passport to a Veggie Planet program, while also encouraging their family members to go vegetarian. That's all the time we have for today. Thank you for joining us, and goodbye.